Thank you for calling the Western Southfield. It will be our pleasure to assist you.
Good afternoon. Thank you for calling the Western Southfield. How am I to reach your call?
I had some questions about an event that was hosted there last month. I was hoping I could talk to somebody there.
Okay. What did you want to know about the event that happened last month?
This was called PinguaCon. It happened April 22nd through the 24th. There is a presenter on Twitter saying that there were bomb threats at this event, and I was trying to confirm if that was true.
There was who what now?
Okay, so they had presenters at this event, right? And one of the presenters is named Patrick Tomlinson. He is on Twitter saying that there were bomb threats at your hotel, and I was trying to confirm if this was true or not.
No, we didn't get no bomb threats.
And you're sure about this?
I believe I wouldn't be here. I'm positive.
Okay.
Wow.
Well, I really appreciate you taking the time. I can give you this person's Twitter handle if you'd like to look into it yourself.
Yeah, I do. Yes, I do, because that's a lie.
Okay, his name is Patrick Tomlinson, and his Twitter is at Stealthy Geek. He also,
Delta Geek, we're going to look this up. If we have to, we'll call the police, because that was a lie.
I appreciate you taking the time to talk to me, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye.
The recording you just heard was a call made by investigative journalist Thomas Apostle to the Westin Southfield Hotel. This hotel was the supposed target of a bomb threat made against Patrick Tomlinson, who alleges it was done by the Opie and Anthony Forums to interrupt PenguinCon, a science fiction convention that Tomlinson was attending. In order to confirm the authenticity of Patrick's story, Thomas Apostle called the hotel where the convention was held and asked staff about what happened. To his surprise, however, they would divulge to him that no bomb scares had occurred at the hotel, and that they would be notifying the police about Patrick's bomb threat lies. Apostle had inadvertently just exposed the fact that Patrick's bomb threat claims were fraudulent. By now, you might be wondering how Patrick consistently fabricates falsehoods without grasping the fact they will be immediately exposed. His assertion of possessing a 140 IQ raises doubts. Why, being blessed with such intelligence, would he do things like tweet a clear picture of his home address, doxing himself to all his trolls and followers, and not realize the potential consequences? Patrick simply seems to not be firing on all cylinders. In our previous episode, we covered Tomlinson's dishonesty surrounding his swattings, and explored the insane rabbit hole that the dark web criminal Tor Swats opened with his wild, and so far, unproven accusation that Patrick is the actual mastermind behind them. But out of the Tor Swats drama, and the attention that being repeatedly swatted bought Patrick, there emerged an even more psychotic and unpredictable character in this ongoing story. Today, we're going to be taking a look at another person who has not only harmed Patrick's reputation and public image, but simultaneously claims to be his ally, and coordinates with him behind the scenes while actively being involved in actions that seem to undermine his credibility and character. Today's video delves into the controversial world of Jackie Singh, who we'll soon learn is a racist online troll, wannabe journalist, and self-proclaimed cybersecurity professional who befriended and partnered up with Patrick shortly after the Tor Swats drama. It is essential to highlight her role in this story, even though doing so opens me up to the possibility of facing retaliation and harassment initiated by Jackie. Merely shedding light on the unsettling situation she has contributed to might subject me to such repercussions, such as the toxicity and insanity embedded in her behavior. As you can imagine, when she and Patrick teamed up, a newfound synergy emerged, propelling their actions to even greater extremes. These two deceitful and disturbed individuals decided to unite their efforts in order to spread lies and provoke as many people as they could. But how did this woman ever gain the trust and respect of Patrick Tomlinson? Upon agreeing to collaborate with her, given the apparent alliance they've established, it raises the question of whether he was cognizant of Jackie's history as an internet troll with a record of hateful, racist, and at times criminal activities. Patrick, who has long claimed to be a victim of stalking by white supremacists, decided to forge an unexpected alliance with Jackie Singh, despite her affiliations with one of the most notorious white supremacists to ever exist. In today's video, expect some peculiar developments as Patrick, who had previously fabricated swatting incidents and bomb threats, enlists Jackie to further diminish the validity of his remaining claims to victimhood. While Patrick's goals seem pretty self-explanatory, attention and publicity, Jackie, on the other hand, is a sort of mysterious riddle wrapped in an enigma, akin to a stinky diaper tightly wrapped around a hot lump of shit that's headed for the trash. That might sound harsh, even juvenile, but as you'll soon see, it's well warranted. In addition to doxing random strangers because she does zero research while pretending to be an internet expert, Jackie is also a racist piece of shit who spent years spreading hate online. Furthermore, she has displayed psychopathic tendencies, infringing on innocent people's privacy, attempting to harm their reputations, and finding amusement in it afterward. We're going to be closely examining what this woman has dedicated her life to, and you might be shocked to learn it isn't a laundry list of good deeds. Before reaching her current state, Jackie spent years as a member of a trolling group known as the Gay Niggers Association of America, or the GNAA, as I'd like to call them from now on. GNAA was an early internet trolling group that formed in the early 2000s. It was mainly composed of hackers and trolls that got a kick out of using their technical skills to create novel ways to shock and annoy people online. The group's ethos evokes a spirit reminiscent of what one would find on sites like 4chan and Encyclopedia Dramatica in the early 2000s. However, some people view them as even more extreme than that. The Terrorism Research and Analysis Consortium went as far as to describe the GNAA as an extremist right-wing terrorist group, citing hateful messages the group left after hacking and defacing Barack Obama's website, and the fact GNAA's president is an avowed white supremacist with a large swastika tattooed on his chest. GNAA members like Jackie enjoyed figuring out ways to troll and shock people on the internet, defacing websites with racist messages, flooding IRC chats with spam, and directing unsuspecting people to shock sites that featured gay pornography and gore images. Patrick, an outspoken advocate against racism, has dedicated years to expressing his strong opposition to Nazis and white supremacy through tweets. His passionate stance leads him to spend hours daily seeking out opinions on Twitter that he considers offensive, engaging in harassment and threats against random people. In addition to his fervent anti-racism stance, if you even remotely align with views he opposes, such as being heterosexual, Christian, or pro-life, he labels you as a racist, meth head, Klan member, harboring intense animosity towards you and viewing you as less than human. It becomes understandable if you recall Patrick also made threats to murder his own wife and newborn baby daughter, resulting in the loss of all custody of his child, something we covered in episode 3. Just as a brief side note regarding Tomlinson's sexuality, he claims to be a straight male. However, I find it weird that Patrick insists that it's normal for heterosexual men to perform oral sex on other men, and that they should be into male ass play. Now, by no means am I homophobic, but what he's describing doesn't sound like any straight sex I've ever heard of. Anyhow, Jackie strongly denies any knowledge or connection to GNAA, despite there being a mountain of evidence that she was involved in the group from 2009 up until 2016. For starters, the archived GNAA website has pictures of Jackie that she shared with the group, going by the name Jax at the time. However, she also used to go by the usernames Find Evil and Leukemia Girl in the past as well. Chat logs later leaked by the Washington Examiner show Jackie Singh using the N-word, being anti-Semitic, and using edgy humor to try and impress her peers at GNAA, frequently spamming racist messages on IRC. Other screenshots from Twitter show numerous tweets between her and Weave. It was also revealed she even occasionally did cam shows on Stick'em for the group, and even allegedly shared pictures of herself with underaged members. Another more dubious online source even claims during her IRC days as a GNAA member, she met and slept with several underage teenage boys she met on IRC. One of the dumbest things she did in this early period, though, in my opinion, was detail in a 2005 blog post how she hacked her next-door neighbor's work laptop and used it to gain unauthorized access into Halliburton's network. She proceeds to end the blog post by calling him a homophobic slur, attempting to comprehend why she would hack her neighbor's work computer and openly admit to this felonious action online defies any reasonable explanation. The leaked chat logs, reckless behavior online, and long association with GNAA would ultimately come back to bite her in a way she never expected. After years of impersonating a cybersecurity specialist, Singh somehow landed a job as a low-level assistant incident responder for the Biden administration's cybersecurity team. While this position was insignificant and likely not given to her based on merit, Jackie still arrogantly boasted about this accomplishment online and seemed to enjoy rubbing in people's faces that she was once a member of a white supremacist cyber terror group before she started working for the office of President Joe Biden. However, Jackie would fly to close to the sun and see herself crash out and burn as a result. It wasn't until after she gained her position as a junior assistant incident responder that the Washington Examiner dropped their chat log bombshell, and the results would be catastrophic. Jackie would be fired from her esteemed position as an intern junior threat responder and be publicly humiliated as knowledge of her years-long membership to GNAA spread online. With her career ruined, Jackie's reputation would never recover. Following her firing from the Biden cybersecurity team, Jackie started a page dedicated to generating crude and offensive AI pornography of Muslim women, referring to it as some sort of art project. I struggle to grasp the intention behind these explicit and racist creations, but it seems to reflect her deteriorating mental state after losing what she believed was the job of a lifetime. In some ways, I guess it makes sense that Jackie would eventually team up with a fellow loser like Patrick. Since Patrick lost his family due to making violent threats, lost his lawsuit because he was too stupid to stop responding to trolls, and lost his blue checkmark and Twitter relevance after being suspended and reinstated. Now, having been swatted a handful of times, Patrick didn't have much left to lose. So when Jackie suddenly appeared in his DMs offering to help with his trolling situation, he was happy to begin secretly conspiring with her against the Opie and Anthony trolls. Regardless of Jackie's actual intentions, Patrick's lack of oversight in vetting her background echoes the Apostlegate saga, which saw Patrick deceived by a troll who gained his trust before humiliating him publicly. Yet I question whether Jackie possesses the same level of cunning as journalists like Josiah and Thomas Apostle.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. Can't touch this.
Similar to Seth and Patrick's actions in the Apostlegate saga, Jackie has levied numerous false accusations against various individuals. The list is extensive, but notable instances include accusing a random Swedish individual of being Tor Swats and asserting that an English teacher in Oman and the son of a federal judge is Quasi. The source of this information remains unclear, but like Patrick, Jackie seems to lack mental stability, often making statements for maximum attention. Also similar to Patrick, Jackie, too, is in a large amount of debt, to the tune of over $70,000 owed to various credit card companies. In addition to that, she apparently owes another $70,000 in unpaid taxes to the IRS, which they are currently pursuing her for now. Tough luck. Apparently, Biden's office missed the memo on lending her a hand in this ironic situation. The O&A trolls describe Jackie as one of Patrick's biggest ball washers. And while their choice of wording is crude, I really can't say I disagree. However, Jackie isn't Patrick's only ball washer, as he has acquired a small handful during his time on Twitter. And I intend to cover this cast of miscreants in a future episode. Strangely, it seems as though an unshakable curse follows all who play along with Tomlinson's antics and stand up for him on Twitter or elsewhere. but I'm afraid the story of these side characters, swept up in Tomlinson's lies, will have to wait for another episode. That's all the time we have for tonight. Thank you for joining us, and tune in next time for another episode of Cryptic Web Chronicles.